Hello, please watch Heaven's Rain program every Tuesday at 8 p.m. on Jesus the Word TV. Hi, I'm Reverend Kevin Snow with Heaven's Rain Ministries, and we're here to continue our message from last week about receiving your miracle. Last week we talked about the three ways, some of the first three ways that we discussed, and one of those was confess your fear and how important that was to understand the confessing of the fear. Number two was receiving faith to proclaim, and thirdly was embracing the truth. Today we're going to talk about the three other ways that we work in conjunction with these three. So if you're taking notes, please just go back to last week's message and refer to that, and then so we can catch up for today, because these were three things that the Lord genuinely taught me on faith. And even as I preach this message, it's reminding me of things that I thought I had forgotten, but the Holy Spirit brought them back to my remembrance, and some of the struggles that we're experiencing today in our world and in our own personal lives. And so we just want to ask the Holy Spirit just to come in and just to speak to us today and reveal His Word to us. So, Father God, we thank you today that your Spirit is moving all over the earth. We thank you, Lord God, that you are still drawing man to yourself. God, that you're bringing us with your kindness and your goodness to repentance, Lord God. We thank you, Lord, that it is your will for every person watching, Lord, and every person on the planet to be saved. And we ask you, Lord God, that your Holy Spirit would just continue to reach into the hearts of people, God, that are listening to this message right now, who are watching, whether it be on the internet, whether it be on TV, and that, Father God, their hearts are being pricked, their hearts are being attentive, Lord God, and they're receiving exactly what you have for them. We thank you that your word does not return void. It does not fall to the ground and matters to nothing. But God, it's for somebody out there today. And we give you thanks that you're doing it in Jesus' name. So we're going to pick up this message again on receiving your miracle. And this was one of the pivotal things in my life that actually transformed and changed my outlook. And from time to time, we need that fresh reminder of what God wants to accomplish and what He wants to do. Because again, there's so many things that are coming against us in our world that we live in. And God wants to teach us something and show us something about His goodness and His grace. And one of those things within the realm of His goodness are miracles and God wanting to do miracles in our lives. Now, God just doesn't shine down miracles just for the fun of it and just so because we can give us everything that we want. God doesn't work that way. There are lessons, there are trials, there are situations that we have to go through to get there. And so, and many times there are struggles that we have to go through and suffering we have to go through till we get to the other side. So I want to encourage you today, if you're in the middle of a mess and you're in the middle of a struggle and you're in the middle of disappointment, you're in the middle of depression, you're in the middle of a financial crisis, I don't care what you're in the middle of, I want you to be able to focus right now and understand something that I'm about to tell you. And that is, God is always in the middle of everything that you're going through. And God always gives you a way out, and God always reveals to you the way that you need to go. The point that we need to learn is, are we paying attention to what God is saying? One of the things that God has recently taught me was that sometimes no, when God says no to something, there's going to be a yes coming up somewhere. And so that no is an answer to prayer. That losing the job, that situation that you're going through, in that no, there is a yes coming up. So you have to gauge yourself, and sometimes it's not the yes you're looking for. It's not the yes that you want, but we understand that God knows exactly what we need and exactly what we want. So prayer number four that we're going to do, and the belief that we're going to do in number four of the four ways, is we have to act like it's done. So we've already gone through confessing our fear. We've already gone through so many of these other different stages. And now our faith is, it's fine-tuned. We're able to see and experience something new and something different in our realm of faith, because now all of a sudden things are turning in our minds and in our hearts. We're more attentive to what God is saying and what God is doing. Now let's recap again and understand that faith does not deny the existence of the situation, whether it's a financial issue, a disease, a death sentence, but rather it's God's perspective, and faith searches for God's glory in that situation. So this is the key element right here. This is where we have to pause and stop and say, okay, where is the glory of God in my situation? Where is it in my financial crisis? Where is it in my diagnosis? Where is it in my situation with my spouse or with my children? Where is the glory of God in that? And I guarantee you the glory of God is in there somewhere. And we have to be able to search that out and find it, because that's where we're going to tap into the will of the Lord. I remember a year or so ago, I was upset because my wife and I were fighting a battle, and in relationship with our children, and I'm like, God, this isn't fair that we're fighting this battle right now. We raised our kids right, we did the right thing, they're off making choices, and yet God spoke to me and He said, I need you to fight this battle. I need you in this battle because you're going to win and other people are going to need your victory. And when God spoke to me that, I shut my mouth after that. I stopped complaining about it. I was like, okay, so there's the word that I needed. It was a no, it was or a not yet. It was not, I'm gonna give you everything you want when you want it. God doesn't work that way for us. Sometimes our miracle is wrapped up in a different package than what we want. So we sometimes have to step back and take a pause and say, I'm going to search for the glory of God in this situation. Because the glory of God leads us into different places that we normally wouldn't go, that the Holy Spirit wants us there, and the only way that He can get us there is through a trial, through a suffering, through situation, because He wants us to meet somebody. He wants us to get in tune, to in touch with somebody that we probably don't know, to share the light of the love of the gospel. Because remember, what you're going through now or what you've been through in the past is your testimony that somebody else needs to hear, because they're in that same position right now. And so this is why we go through things, and this is why God brings us out of things, and this is why some of us stay in the same mess for our entire lives, because we never learned this one valuable lesson to search for the glory of God in that situation. So everything that we go through, including the bad, contains God's glory. And so this is very pivotal in our understanding. This is something that's striking me in my heart right now. With all the things that I'm going through in my life, God's glory is in it. And so I have to understand that, and that the only way that I can switch my eyes and my focus off of all the distractions that are happening is to focus my eyes on the Lord, focus my eyes on His Word, pay closer attention to what He's saying, and begin to take action in this particular realm. When we have faith that comes from heaven, because remember, that's where faith comes from. Faith is the evidence of things not seen. And so we're receiving faith from heaven, because it's not an emotion. It's a God-given gift. It's a God-given thing that He's given us. So it's not an emotion that's based within our faith. This isn't just positive thinking here. So when we receive this faith that comes from heaven, we speak and we declare what God is showing us, even when the circumstances around us completely contradict what is happening. So right now, you might be in the middle of a situation where there is absolutely no reason why you think that anything could happen. You need a miracle, and the miracle is something you know you can't do, no man cannot do. You know only God can do it for you. And so remember, this is what faith. So you're pulling this faith. God has given you this faith. He's depositing this faith within each and every one of us. Now, are you going to use the faith that God has given you? And remember, Jesus said it only takes the faith of a grain of a mustard seed. And so we have to remember that. It takes that little bit of amount. So the point that God is trying to make here is use the faith that I've given you. And you can always pull back on the actions of God and the deeds of God that He's done for you in the past. Every one of us have a past with God. You wouldn't still be serving God today if He hadn't answered some of your prayers at some point in your life. You wouldn't fool around with this. You wouldn't continue. Who would if you were serving a God that never answered your prayers? Well, I'm telling you this, God has answered your prayers, or you wouldn't be watching this video. And here God is speaking to us right now, and He's telling us to pay attention and to search out the glory of God. So when we receive this faith, we speak and we declare. So now our mouth and our head, our action and our hearts are all in unity and in agreement with speaking what God is saying. The circumstances around us haven't changed yet. So, because you have to utter the words that God is telling you to speak, and then you have to hold to them. So in other words, all negative conversation, all complaining conversation, all the other mental garbage that's thrown at us, we stop saying those things. We repent of those things, we stop speaking that way, and we begin declaring by faith that we're going to get our money back from that fraud. We're going to get our situation is going to come back together, our marriage is going to come back together. All these things are going to come back together because God is working on something that within our hearts, and He's revealing something to us if we will take the moment to receive what He has for us. So faith declares God's will and His kingdom into our human existence. So here we are in living on the earth. We know that we're in a fallen world, but we also know that Jesus came, he redeemed man back to God, and so he restored the relationship that even, if not better, that Adam and Eve had with God before they fell. So now we have this relationship, even though the world is still in a fallen state, now mankind has been redeemed. And so now that authority that God gave Adam has been given back to us. And so we don't nearly use the authority that God gave Adam and Eve, but God wants us to use the authority that he's given us. And so we use faith to walk into this. So for example, when a faith-filled person walks into a hospital room of a dying patient, that patient's odds just changed because God's favor that's upon me or upon you who walked into the room just walked into that room. So because of God's favor upon us, that dying patient, if we're walking in faith and we understand the power that God has given us over that sickness, over that disease, over that situation, we understand what God wants to do when we walk in the door, that patient's odds just went up because you are filled with the faith of God. I am filled with the faith of God. So it's horrible when somebody walks into your hospital room, if you're the one in the bed and you're the one who's sick, and they just, oh, I'm so sorry, and I'm so sorry you're going to die, and I'm so sorry things are horrible, and they have no faith, they don't know what to say, they don't know what to do. But enter a man or a woman of God or a child, a little child who has a great faith, and let them pray for you, and the whole situation will take a turn around. And so I remember a certain situation when in Mexico, when I went into a house of a pastor, and he was lying on a bed. He was, I believe, had kidney failure, and they had sent him home to die. The doctors had sent him home to die. Of course, the hospitals there are not exactly up to par. And I just was sitting there and I was focused on him as everybody else was chatting and talking. And the Lord spoke to me and said, I want you to go over and tell him I forgive him, because I heard him moaning something. So I walked over, I told him that God forgave him and God was releasing him of whatever guilt that he had had, and that God was going to give his life back to him. And so we prayed for him and we left. And so the next day I was preaching somewhere else, and this car comes whipping in, and that was his wife driving, and because the Lord had said, I'm going to give you your life back, and I'm going to restore your organs that were failing, the kidneys and things. And sure enough, he had taken a turn for the better. He was already all yellow. Look, his eyes were yellow. He was near death. And his body was swollen, and he couldn't move, and he was in a lot of pain. And by the next day, his body was being restored. The yellow was gone. His color was coming back. And within maybe a month, I believe, he was back on the circuit preaching the gospel, because the Lord had shown me it wasn't his will yet for him to die. And so this is where we have to come into agreement with God's word, that this is not something that we want to toy around with. We want to have faith that believes and faith that walks in miracles, that we have to act like it's done. So the redeemed attitude sees life through God's eyes, not our own eyes, just like Jesus did. And we're able to use this miraculous faith to destroy the works of the devil and build God's kingdom by demonstrating God's desires on the earth. So no longer we're just doing our desires. We're no longer living for ourselves. Now we're living for God and for his kingdom. This is where we'll see people drawn to the light of the gospel like never before. When we start doing this, this is where everything begins to change in the world around us. We're no longer going to be people magnets on our own, and whether or not we can attract people or not. Now the Holy Spirit is going to attract them to us. In Romans 1:17 it says, For in it the righteousness of God is revealed from faith to faith, as it is written, the righteous shall live by faith. So our next one, our fifth one that we want to do, or the second one this evening, is we have to learn how to wait on God. And so this is the interesting one, because this isn't really a correct statement. Have you ever said that before? I'm waiting on God. And you've heard it said, you sometimes we have to wait on God. It's really an incorrect statement, because we're not waiting on God. In reality, God is waiting on us. He's waiting on me to get it right, to get my faith right, to get my spirit and get my head in the game, to stop saying this and stop doing that. He's waiting on me to get in alignment with God's word. The Holy Spirit's still speaking to you, to me, and he's asking us to get it in line, get it in gear, because he will set up. God is patient. He's long suffering. He'll set it up. We'll go day by day, and we'll have hair, and then we'll lose our hair. And before we know it, we're old, and we don't know what, and our day has come that we're going to die, and voila, our time is over. And so this is the only chance that we get as long as we're breathing on the earth to please the Lord. And so waiting, God, we're waiting. We're waiting. We're in a waiting period, but God is waiting on us to get it right. You make that call. I make that call. When am I going to get it right? When am I going to put forth my best effort? When am I going to try? When am I going to take God for His word? When am I going to come into alignment with His will? When am I going to lay mine down and surrender mine and pick up His plan for my life and do it? That's where the key is it right here. So we're waiting on God in the sense of it. God is waiting on us. Because God is always ready. He's always ready to perform. He's always ready to pour out His gifts and pour out His Spirit. He's always ready to bestow His love upon people. He's always ready to bring forth His goodness upon people. He's always there. He's always wanting to do it. He's just looking for a vessel to do it through. We are the ones that are holding up God's promises. You and me. So yeah, so I'm going to say it, lay it out there. I'm not a feel it, preach it, be happy preacher. I'm the one who's going to tell you the truth because I have to hear the truth because it's the only way that we're going to be able to come into alignment with God's word. In Psalm 27, 13 and 14, it says, I believe that I shall look upon the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. Wait for the Lord, be strong and let your heart take courage. Wait for the Lord. See, losing patience with God absolutely makes no sense whatsoever. See, when we are walking and we're living in faith, being patient comes with the territory and we rest. Yes, we rest. Knowing the results are up to God and so is the timing. So whenever I was ever praying for people in the realm of miracles, this is something the Lord taught me early on, and I'm so thankful that He did, that I was able to hear it and receive it, is that the results are not up to me. See, Paul preached, you know, Jesus came or someone else comes and they water or I water or I plant and then I come and I water or somebody else waters. But who gives the increase? Not me, not the pastor, not the apostle, but God gives the increase. And so because God gives the increase, that means the results are up to Him. So I release the results into His care and I let Him do it. Because this is the hard part for many of us. We want to see that instant miracle. We want things to happen. And sometimes, you know, and God forbid we should ever try to deceive anybody with a video trick or some sort of a mockery that we'll be held accountable for in the last days, in our day that we stand before God. We need to understand something, that we need to let God do what God said that He will do. You see, when we're walking, we're living in faith, patient comes with the territory. If we're not being patient with God, guess what? We're living and operating in the flesh. We have turned off the spirit, now we're in the flesh, because God won't reward the flesh. He will not give us the flesh, any fleshly desires. He won't cater to that. He won't give into our carnal nature. He will only partner with us when our spirits are in connection with Him and we're doing His will. Out of the right heart, out of the right mind. So therefore, we have to commit the waiting to Him. We have to commit that to Him. We have to release that to Him in all things and in all ways and let Him do it, because God will not rush it for you. He won't rush it for me. I can guarantee you He has never rushed it for me. But when I get on the track that God wants me on, I can tell you, I sometimes feel like I'm going 200 miles an hour, because when the Holy Spirit takes over and He puts His foot on the gas pedal, I'm telling you, that's when you're going to experience the glory of God like you've never seen it before. And so these are just some of the ways that we do that. So we commit the waiting to Him, and we know that He will bring it to pass in its rightful time and season. So God, help us to be patient with You. Help us to walk in the Spirit, because that's one of the fruits of the Spirit, is patience and long-suffering. So we, God, help us to be patient with You and the answering of prayer. That when we come into faith, that we're not going to go wavering in and out of it, but we're going to stay in faith. And we know what God has spoken to us. We're not being deceived. We're not living in some fantasy world. We're not conjuring something up that's not even true. No, we're actually locked in faith. And we understand that God is going to provide. And we're going to do our part. We're going to, if we need money and you need to go get a job and God told you to go get a job, then go get a job. God will give you the right job. It doesn't matter how many times you were told no. Again, there's always going to be a yes, and that yes is going to be the right thing that God wants you to do. He's going to lead you to the right place. He's going to lead you to the right customer. He's going to lead you to the right business, and God is going to provide for you, but we have to trust in Him. God doesn't want to give you any job. He wants to give you the right job that fits you, that fits your character, that fits your personality, that fits the needs that you have in your life, that where you can shine your light the brightest. And I've been in some pretty awful positions in my life, but I use them as learning experiences to understand what I'm good at, what I'm bad at, what I want to do, what I don't want to do. Because sometimes we just have to get in there, get dirty, get sweaty, and get into the realm of saying, okay, this is something I need to learn in my life. Therefore, I'm just going to follow the process of God, and I am going to learn it. Okay, so lastly, number six, or the last one, this a total of six ways, and or six steps, if you will. The last one is we watch God do it. This is one of my favorite parts, because this is where we just get to enjoy God doing something, because we know it wasn't us. We know that our obedience played a part in it, but we're so humbled when God starts to do something, when God starts to move, we don't dare even touch it at this point. I mean, I'm usually in shock. I'm usually in awe. But at the same time, I'm like, this is God. Of course, this is what God wants to do. And so I'm like, thank you, God, that you were able to even use me in such a amazing way. And so, but we get to watch God do it. So when it comes to miracles, either receiving them or praying into them, know this, again, the results are always up to God. So many will worry about how they will look. This is where a lot of people stumble. This is where I stumbled earlier on in my younger life. That they'll worry about how they look if the person they're praying for does not receive some sort of instant healing. See, sometimes we want the instant to happen so we can feel good about our prayer, so we can feel good about ourselves. And that's pride. That's arrogance. That's the fear of man that's hindering us from truly understanding this principle. So this is where we have to repent of some things, because God is revealing things. Sometimes through that no, guess what? God is going to reveal something to us as why he said no, or why not yet. And so let him reveal, let him speak those things to you, because it's an understanding that we have to have, and we have to grow in this. But once we've obeyed the voice of God, then we walk with confidence knowing God will do what he said he will do. So if that's the key right there, is hearing the voice of God and obeying it. And so there are many times when I've had to obey the voice of God, and it was just like, this is the silliest thing I feel like I've ever had to do. I've had to make huge sacrifices, had to quit jobs, leave places of employment, leave homes, and leave stuff behind, sell things, do all kinds of crazy stuff in the name of the voice of God. And I look back at that, and I look at every single time that I obeyed the Lord and the voice of the Lord when he spoke to me and told me to do something, there was always something better that came later. Now, it wasn't instant. It wasn't a microwave-type miracle where it just comes in, pops out, and then it's mine. Sometimes it took months. Sometimes it took years for that miracle to begin to happen. Sometimes a prayer that was prayed over me 30, 35 years ago is just now coming to pass because I finally got into alignment with what God was trying to do. And sometimes it takes us a long time before we truly understand what God is trying to accomplish in our life. In John 16:13, it says, when the Spirit of truth comes, that's the Holy Spirit, of course, he will guide you into all the truth, all of it. So he will guide us into the truth. The Holy Spirit will never, ever lead us into deception. He'll never lead us astray. He'll never lead us off to the left or to the right. He will always lead us to the truth in God. Always, always, always. He'll never lead us into sin. He'll never do anything that causes us to sin. He'll never do anything that distracts away from the glory of Jesus. The Holy Spirit will never, ever do that. He'll never bring glory upon myself, just for myself, for my own pride, or for my own benefit. He'll never, ever do that. For he will not speak on his own authority, but whatever he hears, he will speak. And he will declare to you the things that are to come. So when we have this relationship with the Holy Spirit who is in us, he will speak to us the things that are to come, and he will give us prophetic utterances and visions and dreams, and he will speak to us about our future and tell us exactly what we need to do. So this is pivotal, and then when we're hearing the voice of God, that when we begin to act on the voice of God, we'll start seeing things happen as they're supposed to happen. So this is acknowledging God's sovereignty over all things, including the working of miracles. This is where we put our full trust in God, and we leave it with him. In some cases, instant miracles do happen. Yay, those are the good ones that we enjoy. But other times, within a few hours or a few days or even over a few weeks, we'll hear about the manifestation of the miracle because God spoke to you something, you obeyed the Lord, and then it began to happen. The point is, each situation is different, and God will not be put into a box. That's what I need to understand that. He'll not be put in a box to a certain method, a certain technique, or a certain strategy. God will always pay attention to exactly what He wants to do in that situation. That's why we have to have a hearing ear for the voice of God, because many times God will not do things the same way twice. So we have to listen and we have to pay attention. And because as soon as something, we get into a habit, because we as humans, we're bad about this. We get into a habit of something and then it becomes religion. And then we want to build a doctrine around it. And then we want to build a shrine around it. And then we think God can't do it any other way. Guess what? He can. God won't be put in our boxes, especially our religious boxes. It doesn't matter what pretty bow or pretty package we put around it, whether it be Pentecostal, Nazarene, Presbyterian, it doesn't matter what name we call it. God doesn't care. God just says, I will do things the way I will do things because I'm God and you're not. So this is where our understanding comes from. In 1 Corinthians chapter 4, it says, now there are a variety of gifts, but the same Spirit, and there are varieties of service, but the same Lord. And in verse 6, and there are varieties of activities, but in the same God, who empowers them all to everyone. To each is given the manifestation for the Spirit for the common good, and then to another the working of miracles. So if you want to work in miracles, these are the six things that God spoke to me and told me, and he brought me back, because it was over 10 years ago when God told me this, and I never wrote this down until just when I was preparing for this message and things. And so God was like, this is what I want you to do. This is how this works. And it brought me back and it reminded me, because I wasn't practicing some of this stuff. And God reminded me of His goodness and of His grace. So we're going to end in a word of prayer. We're going to pray miracles upon you today. And we're going to trust in God that He's going to do exactly what He said He would do. Now, we have a lot to do on our part if we're paying attention. We have a lot to do, but God has given us the ability to do every bit of it because the Holy Spirit lives in us, and so therefore we can accomplish everything that God wants us to do. So let's pray. Father God, we thank You today that Your mercy is being established and that Your kingdom is descending up and coming upon people. God, we thank You for the people that are watching this video today, Lord God. We thank You that Your Spirit is moving in mighty ways. We thank You, Lord God, that Your presence is here in this place. And Father God, and it is wherever these people are watching all over the world, God, that Your Spirit is upon them. Father God, help us and give us eyes to see. This is one of the pivotal things, God, that You always show me. Give me eyes to see, give me ears to hear. Eyes to see what You're doing, ears to hear what You're saying. Just like the Holy Spirit does. He waits for you. Whatever He hears, He speaks. So God, let me have the same words. Whatever I hear is what I speak. Whatever I hear You say, that's what I speak. That's what I partner with. That's what I believe in. That's where I'm going. So, Father God, we want to just not walk in miracles for the fanfare or for the fun. God, it's a humble place to carry the gift of miracles, Lord God. It's a humble place to be able to receive a miracle, God, but yet You've given every single believer at least once or twice, if not multiple times in our lives, God, You've given us miracles. You've shown miracles in our lives. Small ones, middle ones, great ones, it doesn't really matter because they're all miracles because they were all things that only You could do, only You could perform. We understand that, Lord God. We repent of ever thinking that man ever came through on their own. God, no, it was You who spoke to man. It was You who did it. It was You who created the miracle that happened, that brought the food out of nowhere, that brought the money, that brought the job, that fixed the car, that sent an angel. Lord God, You are always the one who brings miracles. You're the only one who can do it. The devil can't bring a miracle. He can't work a miracle. But God, You can, because God, You are the one who just, You want the glory for it, God, and that's the kind of people that we want to be. We want to be the people who walk and display in miracles today, because that's what You want to do, God. You want to win people. And so part of that is showing forth Your glory to a lost and dying generation. And we give You praise and glory and honor in Jesus' name. in Jesus' name. We appreciate you watching this program today. We pray that you will continue to partner with us and watch what God is speaking to us and hear what God is speaking to Reverend Judy and myself and Father God. We're just excited what the Father God is speaking to us through the Holy Spirit, because He's good. And we want to share the goodness of God with you today and always. And we just appreciate what God is doing in your life. We just ask you that you continue to pray, continue to believe, continue to walk in miracles, continue just to receive what God has for you in the name of Jesus.